Good afternoon. Those of you who have still remained here, it's been an exciting annual conference. I'm so glad to be with you. So I'm going to call us to order, and as a first order, before we go to the orders of the day, I'd like us to sing along with whatever the band is going to have us sing.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Sing Holy Spirit. Your presence. together. Holy Spirit, here we go.
I'm so grateful for people who can bring us our souls to God through music. Thank you for the way the band has led us through this whole time. Before Kathy, you can go ahead and lead us, but I want to say, as she's going to the microphone, that Bishop Hagia is in the house. Over there. And it's been so fun to follow him and to have him coach me as I go forward in this role, and I'm just grateful for him. I know you all love him with everything you have inside of you, and so do I. So thank you for being here with us today. Kathy.
Good afternoon, Bishop, Cabinet, and members of the and guests of the annual CalPAC Annual Conference. Welcome to Plenary 5. Now, everybody grab your phones, because once again, I know we didn't have plenary this morning, but just a reminder that we will be voting on our orders of the day after I present them. So we have two slides, and we have lots of good work and 2 hours in which to do it, or just shy of that. And so I present to you the orders, and Bishop, I move the orders of the day.
The motion is before you. Are you ready to vote? All right, pull out your, did I say or no? Oh, okay. Yeah. Pull out your devices, go ahead and vote.
And I forgot to announce that what we're gonna do during legislation in this session is, if after you've pressed your submit button, go ahead and stand up. let's get out of our chairs a little bit. And while we wait for the presentation of the results, it'll get us moving a bit.
And you have approved.
All right, and that'll be your cue to sit down. Thank you.
One sec, would you come and lead us?
I gotta do this every time. Thanks a lot to the band. Mahalo nui loa. Bishop.
Yes.
Cabinet and members, clergy, laity, ohana of the CalPAC Annual Conference, aloha. We are at the last plenary that we have conferenced together. We have found ourselves being filled spiritually. Amen. Yes. And we've been filled physically over lunch. Amen. Yes. Oh, goodness. And if you haven't, let's talk. We'll try to figure out if we can get you in and out afterward. As we've been together, we are grateful that you have been keeping this space holy. As we've moved from place to place, we've been a bit nomadic. We're also grateful that you have made this a silent, holy place with your phones. This is your cue now. You can still vote with it, but please keep it on silent. We're also grateful that you create the silent space that we have conferencing here, and as you have the need to speak outside from usual conferencing, that you find the most comfortable seats outside, or toward the lobby, or as close to Starbucks, or out all the way to the brasserie. We are so grateful that you are finding more holy spaces in this place. A couple of things I want to speak just to our Hawaii travelers. For those of you going back in Hawaii in the group flight, we are flying out tomorrow, so you need to come to the lobby ready by 7:30 to take that shuttle back to LAX. It's not the two-hour drive that we're used to. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So if you need any help, Lorraine Kalaoka, can you raise your hand or stand up? We love Lorraine. Where should we? She's over here, right in front of me. So we love her, so you all know to check in with her. With that, for those cards that we have been writing with so much love for those in Calexico, we remind you again that you can send it over straight to Calexico, or you can give it to Reverend Denise Barnes. Where's Reverend Denise Barnes? Right here. I'm visually impaired, thank you. But if you don't see her here, you'll find us in the back over there. Reverend Julie, who's been coordinating so much of our worship, who's right here, she's letting us know that these plants are available for a wonderful, generous donation going toward the Immigration Crisis Fund. And so if you're interested in donating that way, please come and contact her for that. And for those of you, we're noticing that some of you are lovingly and generously leaving your blessings around on tables and chairs and then seeking for them at the generous hearts of others. So in case you're looking for them, you can find them in room 110, our registrar's office. They have a small lost and found, or the front desk. Just want to remind you again for that. But aside from that, it has been a privilege to be with you. May we continue in holy conferencing together as you pray, as you count down these final moments physically together. Thank you for this blessing. Aloha.
Bishop Hagia to come forward. I want to say a few things as he's coming up to the microphone to give us a CST report. First of all, I want to see if Reverend Dr. Giovanni Arroyo is in the house. There we go. We are glad that you are here. In case you don't know, Giovanni Arroyo is the General Secretary for the General Commission on Religion and Race for our United Methodist Church. And we are grateful for your presence. And also I want to say just a quick word to our LGBTQ folks who are in the house. I understand this is extremely difficult, how we entered this room today. So please know that while we are also loving and trying our best to care for those who are going to disaffiliate, you are well-loved and well-accepted here. Bishop Haggia.
Thank you, Bishop. Happy Juneteenth and happy Father's Day tomorrow for all the dads out there. As a recovering United Methodist bishop, I thought I was done attending annual conference sessions. But God really does have an ironic sense of humor, as I have to attend almost all the Western jurisdiction sessions now because of Claremont School of Theology. I want to thank Bishop Escobedo Frank. Thank God for Bishop Dottie. She has seamlessly led you, and the transition has been wonderful, and we just pray for her always. And she does need some time down because she's also serving as our Western Jurisdiction College president now, and it's a burden that she didn't expect. So we are blessed, Bishop Dottie, for to have you. I want to also thank our wonderful conference staff, especially Bob Rhodes, Kathy Kapp, John Demery. Thank God John is still with us doing that. And also for greetings today for me with Reverend Juan and Margaret Irwin, who made me feel welcome and home. I come today with a kind of a difficult message, but also one of hope. I want to thank you for your commitment to School of Theology at Claremont, Claremont School of Theology. You have given a generous loan, a couple of them, and our hope is to repay that once our final arbitration of our land is done, which has been delayed again and is now scheduled for October or November of the end of this year. As you might know, CST has been chronically underfunded its entire existence. And through the years, it's caught up with them and with us all in the form of them needing to go into debt. But I do want to say that we now have a balanced budget in 2024, and hopefully the land payment will clear all of our loans. We'll be able to pay those off and be able to start fresh with no encumbrances. However, in the short term, our financial challenges are still present, and we need your help and your giving. We are the only United Methodist Seminary in the entire world, that is, who's owned solely by an annual conference. Originally, the combined Desert Southwest and CalPAC, and now, both of you own the school. We are your school, and literally, and every way, that's true. But here's the exciting part. There's a spirit of embarking on a new challenge, a new vision for Claremont School of Theology. We're calling this CST 2.0, or Activating Change. Here's our core values: compassion, justice, and belonging. One more time: compassion, justice, and belonging. And these values will drive everything we do. Now, more details will be forthcoming, but I believe CST can be part of the new church and faith for the future. As you know, I could say this proudly now and not have to play sort of political games around this, but we are unapologetically interfaith, interreligious, welcoming of LGBTQI, affirming of their stance, and always looking to transform the world through our academic standards of excellence. One of our staff members recently divulged to us, and it was quite unexpected in a very small setting, that she had found her identity as a really non-binary person. And she said, after all these years of academic, she found it at CST. And she could proudly say to all of us, without fear of repercussion, that this is her identity now, and this is the way she wants to be addressed. And it was just such a heartwarming experience, but she was received with such care and love by all of us. This is the kind of place that has to be there for people, has to be there for everybody who's looking for a new identity or a way of being themselves. And this is what we're striving to do, transform our students holistically so they may go back to your communities and to places of faith to lead with integrity, but also with a sense of compassion and love. We are not afraid to tackle the vexing problems facing the world. Climate destruction leading to climate change, war and peace, poverty and homelessness, racial inequality, and the polarization of our church and society. I remember as a student, in the ancient days really, but as a student, it was Dean Freudenberger who taught us about climate destruction. I could still remember his lesson. If the mean temperature of the Earth rises 1 or 2 degrees, it will melt the polar ice caps, and there'll be massive climate change and destruction in the entire ecosystem. That was 1975, folks, that Dean taught this and was transforming our lives in terms of being advocates for social and environmental justice. We are now committed wholly to spirituality. And if you saw the latest Barna poll, it reports that all 4 generations of the U.S. would like to grow spiritually. It's at 72% or higher, and Gen X and millennials were at 77% respectively, wanting to grow spiritually. And as our mainline churches continue to decline, CST can be at the forefront of teaching and resourcing a mature and relevant spirituality for all of you, for everyone, and be able to relate to a country that's hungering for that kind of spiritual meaning. We are facing financial challenges, and we must raise a great deal in our annual fund drive to see us through the arbitration, and especially scholarships for our students. This is the hard part. It's almost unthinkable that CST might not be there for us. And this is the hard reality that keeps me up at 3 a.m. at night, most nights. I don't want to soft pedal our issues, but we need you. First, we need your prayers. Second, we need you to make a financial commitment. And what we're doing now is working with the annual conferences of the West to try to work out a way in which we can fundraise in the annual conference itself. And the last thing I'd ask of you is that if you have somebody you know who has means or influence, please reach out to them. And we could follow up with a meeting with them to tell them about our vision and hopes, what we mean to the world, and hopefully they would be willing to give. We need you. It's a desperate time for us, and it's one in which I know the church will never let us down. So I want to thank you in advance for all of these things. Following this short talk, I want to show just a very short clip of a student, one of my favorites, but one who is here in this annual conference. Jerry Okamoto Tanaka is at West LA United Methodist, and she is, I hate to say it, one of my favorite students because I had her in class, and her whole career has revolved around community. She was a lawyer and continues to be active in her local church all these years. But as a layperson, she went through all the ranks, all of the lay classes, CLM classes, course of study classes, and then decided to attend seminary. So for all of you who have this latent passion for ministry, it's never too late. and you just need to seek us out, and we'll welcome you to our classrooms. But Jerry just graduated with her MDiv. We're so proud of her, and if we could show that video now, this will speak volumes to what we mean.
I'm Jerry Okamoto Tanaka, and I just graduated earlier this month from CST with my MDiv in ministerial leadership. And I've had a few different careers over the way. I think they've all kind of led me into ministry, even though I wasn't quite discerning maybe what God's call was for me accurately. But obviously the location of Claremont in Southern California and it being a progressive, inclusive, welcoming campus with excellent professors. And in going through the course catalog, it was like a wish list, right, of looking at all of the different course offerings and seeing so many that were, as I mentioned, compassion classes, narrative classes, religious education, social justice, and spiritual care were the areas that I really wanted to focus on in the ministerial leadership program. There are so many different experiences that I hold precious and dear. One of them is that for the first time in my educational life, I had Asian American women professors. I had never had that before through elementary, secondary, college. I went to law school and I never had that mirror. And so that was a wonderful experience to have. I think one of the greatest gifts that I take away from this is that what I was learning in the classroom was not something that was disconnected from what was going on out in the world. Everything I learned in the classroom was relevant, not just in my church, but in my daily life. So I am grateful to all who have supported Claremont over the years of the life of this institution and all of the many people who have gone out into the world to make, it sounds trite, but to make the world a better, more loving place, the beloved community that we are all seeking. And so continued support of CST, especially in this new chapter of life, moving to a new campus, and moving to 21st century ways of doing seminary and doing ministry can help to support this effort and this ongoing story of CST in the community and of people enriching the world with compassion, belonging, love, service in ways that can change lives, especially the life of the student.
Thank you from the bottom of my heart, and we look forward to working with you very soon. Thank you so much.
We're going to say a prayer for Grant and for the school. God, thank you so much for all the ways Claremont School of Theology has just given us a foundation over the years, and for all the ministries and persons whose lives have been changed because of their teaching and preparing us for ministry. So today, I pray that you'd be with Bishop Grant, President Bishop Grant, and that you would help him as he seeks out the resources, that you would open up the doors to provide all that is needed for the school to continue. And we're grateful for his honesty and for the leadership that he brings. Give him rest, even at 3 o'clock in the morning. In Jesus we pray, amen. Amen.
Thank you so much. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, we have a retirement video coming up. These are fun.
I'm Lynn Reese. I'm currently serving the people of Indio at Shepherd of the Valley United Methodist Church. Since my ordination in 1996, my mission has been to introduce people to Jesus Christ and help them grow together to be devoted disciples. So I have invited some of my former and current congregants to share with you how my ministry has helped them in their spiritual journeys.
My name is David Nesamoni. This is my wife, Mary Nesamoni. We belong to University United Methodist Church in Redlands. Pastor Lynn Reese was my pastor at the University United Methodist Church in Redlands for 3 years. During that 3 years, she was the best for the whole congregation, not only for me. Her messages, her suggestions, her advice, everything inspired us, motivated us to do better and better in our spiritual life. It was Pastor Dr. Lynn Reese was the reason for who I am today as a disciple of Christ. With Pastor Lynn Reese retiring this year, I wish her good luck. I wish her the best of life. And I say that the best is yet to come, Pastor. God bless. Amen.
Hello, I'm Janet Weissong.
And I'm Bill Weissong.
Pastor Lynn has been a real blessing in our lives. One very meaningful aspect of our experience at Shepherd of the Valley happened during the pandemic. She mentioned her personal morning time with God. She invited anyone who wanted to join her and share a meaningful half hour. So we did, along with 27 or so others. We still meet Monday through Friday on Zoom, reading scripture, sharing a daily devotion, and praying over a list of folks we gather from all walks of life that are in need of our prayers.
This time of devotion, Bible reading, and prayer has helped us feel closer to God, and we have made an amazing connection to those we call our church family. It is our belief that Lynn's spirit is reflected in our church family. We wish Pastor Lynn well in her retirement, and we extend to her our love and friendship.
Congratulations on a job well done, you good and faithful servant.
During a very dark time in my life, Pastor Lynn Reese shone the light of God's love on me. She invited me to join a Bible study and taught me, by example, how to be present, loving, and dedicated. Pastor Lynn helped me to feel connected to our fellowship and to develop an intimacy with my Lord. She reminded me how very loved I am, and God is always with me, and I am never, ever alone. Thank you, dear Lynn. Thank you.
As I transition to retirement, I look forward to working with all of you here in the CalPAC Annual Conference. I leave you one piece of advice. Wherever life's journey takes you, find a way to enjoy the journey. Bye.
If Reverend Dr. Denise Barnes would please come and give us a report on the solidarity for the hotel workers.
Good afternoon, conference. Good afternoon. Before I start this next one, I just want to let you all know our kids are listening to us. Today, the CalPAC kids made boxes to go around and collect money for UMCOR and raised $166. I'm just going to say a few words and then introduce you to people who are doing far more than me and more effectively and can help you help others. But I want to introduce this by quoting Jeremiah 22:13, which tells us, "Woe to those who build their house by unrighteousness and their upper rooms by injustice, who makes their neighbors work for nothing and does not give them their wages." And 1 John 3:17 asks us, how does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a sibling in need and yet refuses to help? Our social principles state that every person has the right to a job at a living wage, which has reasonable working hours and provides a safe and healthy environment. The sessions team were very intentional about choosing a venue which was a union hotel, and we are very grateful for that. However, the contracts for many of the workers at this hotel and many, many others across the city will expire at the end of this month. For more about what that means and what we can do to help, I'm going to hand you over to Pastor Bridie Robert of Unite Here Local 11, Reverend Jennifer Gutierrez of CLUE, and Reverend Karen Ellis, who chairs our Abolition Task Force.
Hello, conference. Wonderful to see you. Thank you, Bishop and Cabinet, for having us. My name is Pastor Bridie Roberts. I proudly serve as Associate Pastor at Hollywood United Methodist Church. And in the rest of my time, as the Director of Community Organizing for Unite Here Local 11. We are the labor union that represents hotel and restaurant workers here in Southern California and in Phoenix, Arizona. So all of Los Angeles, Orange County, Long Beach, Santa Monica, and Phoenix. Tourism is the largest economic generator and engine here in our region. A lot of people think this is a Hollywood town because we've got a big sign, and at our church we like that. But we know that it's the beaches, the palm trees, the incredible events that happen here, and the people who serve that bring people from around the world. Our union represents 34,000 working people and their families. And their families, right? And what that means is those folks who are part of our union have an opportunity to work in a place that is under contract where they have a say and a voice in how they are treated and where they can fight for better conditions for all people inside. But the members of the tourism industry here in California and probably across the country were uniquely impacted by COVID-19 pandemic. Now, all of us experienced loss during that period and there was great economic impact across our entire country. But in our union, within the first 2 weeks of the public shutdown orders, our members experienced 95% unemployment. I want to let that sit with you for a moment. So the first order came and people were not allowed to travel for tourism and they didn't want hotels to stay open for tourism. So they closed the hotels. That was half of our members, 15,000 people, and their families. And then the universities were deciding whether or not to send children home. Is it safer at home or is it safer here? And they sent them home, and we were glad for that, right? But the people who cleaned the rooms and prepared the foods also were sent home, mostly without pay and benefit. Then there were no more large events. All the sporting events closed, all the stadiums, concerts, everything closed. And that's thousands of our members at Staples, at Dodgers, and event centers across our entire region, who went home without pay and deep worries about their future. And then the LA Times published a front page article that said, it's safe to fly, just don't eat the food. That's 6,000 workers in factories surrounding this hotel that put food on an airplane who were also sent home. It was a difficult fight, and we had to fight for our members to be able to return to work, to be able to maintain their health insurance, to be able to live during that time. And many of you joined me at food banks, and many of you joined me in the streets as we fought for a future, not just for our members, but the entire tourism industry. And so I'm here to tell you that we're back, baby. Right? Tourism in Orange County, Los Angeles, and in Phoenix, Arizona is now pre-pandemic level of prosperity. February of this year is higher than February of 2019. It's pretty amazing, right? But only two-thirds of the workers who do those jobs have been returned to the workplace. Inflation has hit every person in this country. And what $20 could buy 5 years ago, 3 years ago, it doesn't cover now. Gas prices are up, and our people are struggling. On June 30th, contracts representing 17,000 workers at 100 locations in Southern California and in Phoenix will expire. Workers are fighting for a better future for them and their families, but not just for them, for the entire industry. My brother Eli is going to tell you about that, but I just want to put a couple of those things on the table. They're looking for wages to sustain a family for the future. We must address the workload. If hotels are back at pre-pandemic levels, but only two-thirds of the workers are back, who's doing the other third of the work? Eli and his coworkers, and maybe you've noticed that there's no daily room cleaning here. That is a back-breaking decision on the back of housekeepers, and not one that's been offered to us to make. It's a management decision. We need a restoration of work levels that are safe and sane. Our workers need retirement with dignity, which they do not have. And they need the opportunity to share what they have in places where workers do not yet have representation. And so they are fighting for all of this and more, including powerful equity justice proposals, calling on hotels to invest in an affordable housing fund for tourism workers in this region. We know that they can do it because they charge a surcharge every night for things like, I don't know, there's one called like an urban amenities fee and, you know, all kinds of stuff like this. Why not housing for the people who have invested in making the industry flourish? Our brothers and sisters in Hawaii who work in the industry also know this story. It's the same. And so together, the workers have come. They've been through a period of deep discernment over the last year. And last Thursday, they gathered to vote, including in some of our churches, on whether or not they would participate in a strike if necessary. And more than 96% voted to strike across the industry if their needs are not met. And so we are going to be in a place where we are called into deep solidarity. But first, I want to ask Eli to share with you a little bit about why folks made that choice.
Good afternoon. My name is Eli Quinones. I work in this hotel, Sheraton Hotel, for 33 years. I'm a shop steward for the union, fighting for the rights of the workers, my co-workers. The quality of living in Los Angeles is too expensive. We're only asking a little bit, a raise, and a health insurance to where can I lose it. So yesterday we were talking to the owners, and they just step outside. They said, we're not going to deal with you guys. So that's why we're going to strike the hotel so we can get better living in Los Angeles. The gas is so expensive. I am coming from San Fernando. It takes me 2 hours to get here to work. I spend a lot of gas to get here. And with this salary I have, I cannot make it. So that's why I'm striking for the rights and respect so we can have health insurance and better wage. Thank you.
Thank you, Eli. I want you to see Eli, and we've been seeing wonderful workers across this hotel, and thank you for wearing your buttons. Eli was laid off for 3 years without health insurance and has just returned to work. The conditions that workers are facing are very difficult, but they are walking really with a spirit of compassion, justice, and belonging, just like we laid out. Our union is very engaged and has been in deep relationship with the religious leaders of our community, with CLU, and our organizing philosophy and theology, I call it, is really shaped with a heavy hand by Reverend James Lawson, who's been a thought partner for us for 2 decades. So I'm not going to sit here talking points, whatever, but we seem to be a secular institution, but our people are people of faith because it takes faith to believe that you can move mountains, and they believe that every day. So I want to turn it over to Reverend Jennifer Gutierrez.
Thank you, Brady. So my job is to tell you how we all fit into this, the people of the United Methodist Church, the people of the CALPAC Conference. So let me tell you, first of all, where we all fit into history. You're all familiar with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and his use of nonviolent direct action during the civil rights movement, right? So Dr. King was a Baptist minister with a deep theological understanding of the practice of nonviolent resistance and its capacity to transform the world. He was joined in his efforts by one of our own clergy brothers from this annual conference, Reverend James Lawson, pastor emeritus of Holman United Methodist Church in Los Angeles. Yeah, shout out to Holman. Reverend James Lawson is often called the architect of the civil rights movement. He studied nonviolent resistance. He and Dr. King studied it together. Reverend Lawson advised Dr. King on strategy, training many of the people that participated in march-ins and sit-ins and other actions that helped end legal segregation and change the lives of people of color in this country. Now, Reverend Lawson is one of the founders of CLU, Clergy and Laity United for Economic Justice. an organization he helped create to carry on this important work of the civil rights movement, continuing to fight for economic justice for low-wage workers and racial justice for people of color that continue to be the most exploited members of our society. But I also want to tell you that Dr. King and Reverend Lawson did not invent nonviolent direct action as a tactic for making change. They merely stepped into a long tradition that began at least 2,000 years ago with Jesus of Nazareth. We see Jesus' commitment to this type of resistance to the power of his time in both his actions and his words. I have to say, Jesus was no stranger to political theater. You have to think of his triumphal entry into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. After this march into the center of power, complete with chants meant to arouse the ire of the leaders of his time, Jesus spent a week going back each day, preaching, teaching in the streets in front of the temple until he was finally arrested. Dr. King and Reverend Lawson were guided by Jesus' actions, and I try to be as well. So that's why next week, along with a number of other folk here in this room, have already signed up, a number of other pastors, lay members of this annual conference, and other faith leaders from throughout Southern California. CLU is an interfaith organization, and so there'll be folks from different religions joining us as well on an historic march to one of our centers of power. Jesus was working to liberate the poor of his day from oppressive Roman rule. We will be focusing on a group that is oppressed in our time, hospitality workers. Workers that spend their days serving others but not receiving enough in return to cover their basic needs. You heard Eli say that he commutes 2 hours from San Fernando every day, 2 hours to get to work. Now, I can't imagine what that takes away from him, his personal health, his time with his family, his ability to be part of his church and his community. This is a loss not just for Eli and his family, but this is a loss for all of us. So this coming Thursday, June 22nd, we will be gathering at a local church near here to receive nonviolent direct action training, and then over 2,000 people will be participating in a historic sit-in just down the street here on Century Boulevard. 300 of us will be committing civil disobedience, risking arrest. And we invite you all to join us. There's still time to sign up. Now, you might have seen these cards sitting on the Abolition Task Force table out there. We're going to do this the old school way. If you haven't signed up yet to participate in this historic action, I ask you to do so. Put your name and your contact information on here, the name of your church, and you can just hand it to me or to Bridie or anybody that you see out in the hallway. Now, let's see if you're... Maybe you're not a person who's feeling quite up to risking arrest at this time, or maybe you're out of town on the 22nd, but there's other ways that you and your congregation can support workers like Eli. You can sign up for the Mutual Aid Committee that will help support the workers if they go on strike. Your congregation or women's group, your youth group, your men's group, whatever, can adopt a picket line near you. And that's a way that you can be in relationship with that particular group of workers. Going out and singing on the picket line, offering prayers or blessings, popsicles, whatever it is, to provide support throughout their ordeal. I'm going to invite Karen Ellis now to come up and talk about another practical way that you can help support right now. But we appreciate you all joining us in this struggle for Eli and the other workers.
I'm Reverend Karen Ellis. I am the co-chair of our Abolitionist Task Force for our annual conference. Leah Switzer is the other co-chair, and she cannot be here today. We were invited by these wonderful people to come along and partner with them on this important act of justice because we know that a living wage is one way that helps prevent human trafficking. Because when a person or a family is able to support themselves through a living wage, they are not fallen into the complexities and trappings of human trafficking. So I am here today to help you do a practical way to help all of our workers who we are supporting today. The ushers are coming around handing to you two cards. The first is a smaller card that says, "We stand with you." You are invited to write a note on the back of that card to one of the workers, and these will be handed out to the workers in this hotel and in others to show them that they are not alone in their struggle. You can simply say on the back that we're thinking of you, God loves you, I love you, whatever is on your heart, to let them know they are not alone in this fight for a living wage and for justice for themselves and their family. The second card is a prayer card, and we can all pray. That is something we can all do. So the prayer card has a pray for every day, 7 days, so you can take this home. Pray every day for our workers, pray for the business owners that they might change their ways and be illumined by God's grace. Pray for ourselves that God's Spirit might empower us to help others. And if you need more of these cards to take home with you to hand out, let us know and we will get those for you. But now I invite you to be with me in a moment of prayer. God of justice and compassion, of healing and hope, of love and grace. Oh God, you are always with us. No matter where life takes us or what we do, you are always there, and for that, we are grateful. Now, gracious God, we ask that you empower us to stand with one another. Be with the workers who are hoping for and fighting for a way to support themselves and their families. Be with politicians and business owners, that their hearts and their ways of doing business will be filled with your grace and your welcome and your abundance. Be with all of us, O God, as we stand with all of your beloved community. Help us to hear one another's stories. Help us to open our hearts and open our hands so your acts of justice and mercy will be done. Gracious God, we ask that you empower us all to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you all of our days, so that we might build up your beloved community. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Bishop. Thank you so much. Thank you. We have a retirement video.
As I reflect on my 40 years of pastoral ministry, the word that keeps coming to me is gratitude. I think it's because, as challenging as ministry can be, there are always so many good people who walk alongside you. For me, it's been my children, Ethan, Hannah, and my bonus daughter, Wendy, and of course, always the faithful love of God. I started out ministry in the church of my childhood, following in the footsteps of my granddad, the Reverend Norval Richardson. At the age of 5, I was already helping him to print and fold the Sunday worship bulletins in his parsonage study for the small rural church he was serving in northwestern Washington. Going forward during worship for the children's time was special for me because it was my granddad who was giving the story. When I was 12, my granddad baptized me in my home church near Chicago, and he was present in June 1983 when I was ordained. And along with others, he laid hands on me. I'm grateful for his role in inspiring me toward a life of ministry. I'm also grateful to Bishop Jack Toole for welcoming me into the conference in 1990, and for the Reverend George Walters for finding me my first appointment in Imperial Valley, a place I grew to love. I'm grateful to have been given opportunities to serve in vastly different ministry settings over the years, including the rural farming community in Hopeville, as a campus minister at the University of Hawaii, Manoa, as chaplain in the United States Air Force Reserves for 9 years, in the beautiful coastal community of Los Osos, California for 10 years, where I met the love of my life, Dallas, and we enjoyed 19 years together before she died 2 years ago. In the lovely community of Santa Maria, California for 4 years before being moved to First United Methodist Church of Santa Barbara 9 years ago. I'm grateful for opportunities to lead interfaith efforts such as the Central Coast Clergy and Laity for Justice for several years and an annual interfaith Thanksgiving service here in Santa Barbara. Among the things I'm most proud of are starting new ministries in each place I've served. Showers of blessing for our unhoused neighbors, crop hunger walks and Sierra service project trips, UMCOR mission trips, and leading the Santa Barbara Church through the process to become a reconciling congregation 5 years ago. All along the way, there have been gifted and caring laity with whom to partner in ministry, many exceptional colleagues, and the reward of serving God and helping to make the church more loving, more just, more inclusive. Thank you all.
Hi, I'm Sunny Ahn, clergy from Kona United Methodist Church on the Big Island of Hawaii. Today, I am here to ask Bishop in the body of Kaupe Conference for the point of a privilege.
For what?
Personal privilege. May I talk?
Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. As we talk about welcoming and stand together and pray for others who are suffering and in pain, throughout the conference, I was not able to neglect my Korean siblings and peace in Korean Peninsula. So I'm here to speak about it, since we have not heard any pains and struggles we are going through in Korea. About 23 years ago, when I was a newborn baby pastor, puking all of the places, and received my first cross-cultural and cross-racial ministry appointment, I received a profound statement and question. Sunny, you are a Korean. Tell me about Korea, your country. At first, I thought it was a ridiculous statement and question because I immigrated to America when I was 15 and finished all my education in America. Until I received a cross-culture and cross-racial ministry appointment, no one told me that I was expected to know about Korea and behave like a Korean girl. So, however, after thinking for a month, for a moment, I responded with a smile, as you know. I know I do not know much, but I will get back to you after learning something about Korea and my Korean-ness, and we will learn together. With the same spirit, I confess that for much of my life, I did not know much about peace and reunification efforts between North and South Korea. I was taught to dream the American dreams and focus on the future, not the past, since there is nothing I can do about it. Soon, my non-Korean siblings and neighbors found that I am a Korean. They start to tell me about the Korean War and their service in the Korean War. So I would like to invite all of you who served in the Korean War in our midst to stand if you are able. Not many, huh? If you have a family members or friend who served the Korean War, please stand. Let us express our appreciation to those families and friends. Thank you, you may sit. I am who I am today because of your service in your friends' service. Thank you. Today I'm speaking before you because of the Korean War. July this year marks the 70 years of a Korean armistice. Korea is the only divided country in the world right now because of this agreement.
We're running out of time. Can you wrap it up, please, real quick?
Wrap it up with a prayer. Definitely.
That'd be great. Thank you.
All right, let me wrap it up with a prayer. Let us pray. 은총의 하나님, 우리를 평화와 통일의 길로 이끄소서. 우리 민족은 고려와 조선을 거치면서 천년 동안 하나의 나라였습니다. 그러나 일제강림기가 끝나면서 외세에 의해 남과 북으로 나뉘어졌습니다. 한반도가 둘로 나뉘어졌을 뿐만 아니라 냉전 시대의 대리전 같은 비극적인 한국 전쟁을 치렀습니다. 전쟁은 남과 북 모두에게 깊은 상처를 남겼고 그 상처는 여전히 평화와 통일을 향한 우리의 발목을 잡고 있습니다. 주님, 우리의 깊은 상처를 치유하여 주옵소서. God of peace, God of justice, we come to you in prayer for people in our fragile world who suffer from war, violence, political tension, environmental damage, and unjust distribution of resources. We especially pray for peace in Korean Peninsula today, which has been divided for 70 years without any means of connection and communication between families, relatives, friends, and people in North and South. We cried with our Korean siblings today, hoping for peace to bring down the walls of hostility, pain, and agnosticism. Oh God, open a new way of peace and reconciliation this 70th anniversary year of the Korean War armistice. As the Israelites were freed after 70 years of Babylonian captivity, pour out your spirit of forgiveness, reconciliation, and healing on people in North and South Korea. Expand the spirit of peace and restoration from Korea to all nations and places in our global village. Oh God, make us an instrument of your peace, both in word and action, internally, externally, relationally, and systematically. Send us, oh God, in the power and love we know who is Christ. Amen.
Amen. Reverend Leah Booth, would you come and lead us through our legislation?
Thank you, Bishop. Good afternoon, Bishop Dotty, members of the annual conference. We have a few more pieces of legislation to cover in this session. We'll cover resolutions 2303, 2304, and 2305, so I encourage you to take out your voting devices and get them ready now. Our first item is resolution 2303, a petition to the General Conference for a General Commission on the Status and Role of LGBTQIA+ people. This is brought by members of the Annual Conference. It can be found on the Annual Conference 2023 page, calpacumc.org/AC2023. Bishop, I move resolution 2303.
The resolution is before you. Do we have microphone four?
Thank you, Bishop. Drew Davis, North Coast United Methodist Church, Oceanside, California. It's a blessing to be able to stand up here and speak in favor of this because within our family, we have a unique situation. I have a bisexual daughter, a transgender son, who have grown up supported by the church. Both came out at youth group or in a church service and immediately received support in their lives. Because of that, Thursday morning, as I'm crying now, I was crying on the other side of the room as my son spoke in front of the church. That support that pulled that through. I want to speak in favor of this because my kids have something that their LGBTQIA plus siblings don't all have. They've been hurt by the church. They've been pushed away by the church. They have not been strengthened by the church. And because of that, we do have issues of individuals that don't have places where they can turn to support where they should receive it. We have instances of suicide because of people who cannot get support where they need to get it. My family has a blessing that I want other families to have. So I support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone else need to speak to this? Remember, if you do come up, there is a timer that will show up, and at the last minute, you get 2 minutes total at the last minute. It'll start timing you. All right, looks like we're ready to vote. The motion is before you. Take out your devices and vote now. What are they doing?
They're just standing, they're just stretching their legs after they've voted.
Okay, then.
They're just stretching their legs.
That's good.
Nothing else. Just stretching their legs.
All right. I need no more stretch.
Moving a bit. It's self-care.
All right, you have approved.
Our next item is Resolution 2304. Affirmation of Queer Delegates Call. This is brought by members of the annual conference. It can be found on the annual conference 2023 page. Bishop, I move resolution 2304.
The motion is before you. Microphone four.
Jason Takagi, lay jurisdictional delegate from San Luis Obispo United Methodist Church. I rise to speak in favor of this resolution. We are asking for the support of the annual conferences of, on behalf of all of the general and jurisdictional delegates as we go into this very difficult time before the general conference. This resolution has been was supported at all five of our jurisdictional conferences this past fall, and we hope that it will also be supported here in CalPAC. We thank you all for all of the support that CalPAC, I know, has given to us as the delegation throughout this very long time as being a delegate. Thank you.
Well, mine is to make a different motion. I'm sorry.
A different motion.
Okay. So we'll vote. Microphone one.
Yes, Lori Meadows of Pasadena First, laity. And I just like to let the conference be aware that part of this motion has already been heard by the Judicial Council and voted down. So just for your information.
Okay.
Not all part.
Any other? All right. Looks like we're ready to vote. Take your devices out and vote now.
Sorry. Yeah, exactly.
It has passed. All right, microphone three.
Bishop, I ask for a point of privilege to make a motion from the floor.
A point of privilege to do what?
I'd like to make a motion from the floor.
Okay.
With your blessing.
Yes.
The motion is, so first I forgot to tell you, okay, my name is Theodore Smith. I'm from Fountain Valley United Methodist Church. Beautiful California.
Can you speak into the microphone? I'm having trouble hearing.
My motion is, I move that the bishop review with the Board of Trustees the disaffiliation terms and conditions under paragraph 2553 of the Book of Discipline for fairness, equity to ethnicity, and in Christian grace and love for both the conference and any and all churches seeking disaffiliation by July 25th of 2023. That's my motion. And if need be, I'm available to speak to it.
Do we have a second? All right, you can go.
There is a large or small body of people within our church who wish to pray the Bible and the Book of Discipline here to those as they see the Bible as it is now and how they see the Book of Discipline as it is now. They believe the Bible is the unerring Word of God, and so they follow it strictly. I'm one of those people that follow the Bible strictly. We're asking for your grace and your kindness because you are the majority, and we have no ill will about that. That's a blessing that you let us go so that we can pray and do our faith as we see fit, as we see the Bible calling us. And it's my hope that in that grace, that at some time with all these issues that are before us, that one time that we can work together for those issues, but allow us a chance with some grace to go forth our own way. Thank you.
All right, so the motion is before you. Can you restate the, oh wait, before you, don't go very far. Does anybody want to speak to this motion? Question?
Calling the question?
Oh, you're calling for the question. Okay, looks like we're ready to vote. There is a motion before you to Ted, would you state it, the one sentence motion?
Yes, I will. The motion is, I move that the bishop review with the Board of Trustees the disaffiliation terms and conditions under paragraph 2553 of the Book of Discipline for fairness, equity to ethnicity, and in Christian grace and love to both the conference and any and all churches seeking disaffiliation by July 25th of 2023.
Thank you. Looks like you all are ready to vote, so let's pull it up on the screens. Okay, vote now. Carrie, it did not pass. Thank you. Microphone three.
Thank you, Bishop. I'm Glenn Hayworth, clergy, Fountain Valley in the South District. I want to request a ruling of law from you, Bishop, referencing paragraph 2609.5. I believe you have a printed copy of this. Concerning your ruling yesterday on my motion that it was out of order based on judicial council decisions 1420, 1457, and 1458. I ask, is this a correct reading of those decisions? And further, does this ruling, if overturned, but too late for churches to conclude disaffiliating from the California Pacific Annual Conference by December 31st, 2023, mean that the deadline to disaffiliate using paragraph 2553 of the Book of Discipline can and or will be extended beyond the expiration of paragraph 2553?
All right, I receive that as a request for a ruling of law, and under paragraph 2609.6, I have 30 days to make a ruling, and on my decision of law, together with your request, will be sent to the Judicial Council for review.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, Leah.
Our next item is Resolution 2305. This is brought by members of the Annual Conference. It's a call to remember, affirm, and encourage women in church leadership. You can find this legislative item on the Annual Conference 2023 page. Bishop, I move Resolution 2305.
The motion is before you. Does anyone want to speak to this? Microphone 4.
Greetings, Reverend Sandy Richards, clergy from Los Altos United Methodist Church, and I rise in support of this as we need to affirm women of all kinds in ministry. And this request is, we believe, a reaffirmation of our commitment to the well-being of the women of our conference.
Thank you. Anyone else want to speak to this? All right, are you ready to vote? Oh, wait a minute. We have somebody coming to microphone 4.
Dick Crawford, Santa Monica First Lady. I would support this wholeheartedly, except for a couple sentences, and I would like to make a motion. I would move that we delete sentences 53, 61, 62, and 63, those four lines. Do I have a second on that?
Is there a second?
Lines 53, 61, 62, and 63.
Okay, we have a second.
May I speak to that now?
Yes.
Can you restate your name?
Can you restate your name, please?
Dick Crawford.
Thank you.
Santa Monica First Lady.
Okay, you can speak to it.
My problem with these sentences is that while I think it is an absolutely wonderful and good thing for us to celebrate the role of women and how we have been able to advance it over the years, I don't think we need to do this at the expense of another church, another denomination. If we leave those lines in there, and I happen to be a Southern Baptist, that's an if, I'm not a Southern Baptist, I would read that as meddling in our internal affairs. And no matter how we want to nuance it, anything like that, I would read it as an attack on the way they read the Bible, and the Methodist Church is telling them that they're doing it wrong. And I don't think we want to be in that position at all. First of all, we shouldn't do it because it's just not Christian. And second of all, we shouldn't do it because it opens the door for other groups to tell us that we're not doing things right and for them to come meddle in our affairs. So I would not be able to support this resolution as it stands with those first lines in there. But I would like to be able to vote for the rest of the resolution, which is why I'm moving that we take those lines out.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Does anyone want to speak to that, for or against? This is the amendment that we're on. All right, looks like you're ready to vote. You can take out your devices. And vote now. The amendment has not passed. Now there's a motion before you, 2305. Are you ready to vote? All right, let's vote. Now. It has carried.
Bishop, this concludes our legislative items for this plenary. Thank you so much.
Bishop, microphone two, we're going to recognize you then. We're going to go to video, and then I see we have some others after that.
Richard Bentley, retired clergy, personal privilege. On behalf of the Methodist Federation for Social Action, which has existed since 1907, we announced our Mildred Hutchinson Award winner for this year. By the way, to remind you, Mildred Hutchinson spent 70 years working for social justice and was known as the conscience of the United Methodist Church. And this year's winner, I don't know if she's here, is Reverend Amy Waukee. Are you here anyway?
Yes, she is.
And in the spirit of brevity, what she has done is long, but she spent many years working for Pacific Islanders and their rights and immigrants. And she's also worked extensively around the act of repentance for the illegal overthrow of the Hawaiian monarchy in 1894, including a resolution to this coming General Conference. Thank you, Reverend Amy.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to a retirement video, and then I'll come over here to you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Dear colleagues in ministry, friends in faith, I want to thank you all for your presence wherever you are, living out our faith to make the world a better place. I'll share a bit about my journey to this point, this day. It begins at First Paris, First United Methodist Church of Paris, Texas, where I was in NYF, where I was baptized, where I was confirmed. And years later, when I answered the call to ministry, I was invited back to share communion with Reverend Gary Reagan, who is the pastor who baptized and confirmed me. I'm grateful to all who were part of my journey in seminary. I'm grateful to the people of First United Methodist Church in San Diego, the place where I first expressed my sense of call to ministry, first to Reverend Molly Vetter, then to Reverend Jim Standiford. All the people of First Church in San Diego buoyed me and encouraged me and prayed for me so that I could become a United Methodist minister. From there, I went to Mission Hills United Methodist Church, where I spent 10 years in loving relationship with a congregation, small but mighty, who loved worship, loved singing, loved prayer. And finally, I was appointed here to Claremont United Methodist Church, a reconciling congregation for 30 years. What a joy it was to step into leadership in this congregation as out queer clergy and to be embraced and to also have my partner, Dr. Marsha, be embraced as well. Thank you for letting us be ourselves as we experienced God's love for us and as we follow Jesus. You know, the hardest part of this appointment was what was hard for all of you. It was the pandemic. And I learned how to preach to a phone camera. And after a few weeks, I no longer saw the phone. I saw all of you. I began to see God's people on the other side of that phone, and we all stayed connected in that time. And there's one other group of people I'd like to thank. Many of them are known only to themselves and to me. But since 2009, it has been my privilege and my joy to answer the call of mine that is to serve other servants by walking with candidates for ministry as they prepare for their board of ordained ministry papers and interviews. And as many of you know, my best friend in the Trinity is the Holy Spirit. I'm an unabashed fangirl of the Holy Spirit, and so may God's Spirit travel with all of us in the next phases of our journey. Thanks be to God.
I'm going to recognize microphone one, please.
Thank you, Bishop. Good afternoon. I'm Wanda Bethia, and I am co-chair of the Camp and Retreat Ministry Committee.
And I am Rachel Tabutel. I'm Wanda's co-chair. Kenny Funk is standing behind us as the director of camping ministry. We'd like to ask our committee members to rise if they are present in the room. Many of them have gone home.
Yesterday, our annual conference approved the sale of our beloved Camp Colby. And during part of that discussion, our sister in Christ, Sue Ann Ware Diaz, asked if some of the reparations for the atrocities committed to and still being experienced by our Native American committee would be considered. The leaders and the staff of Camping and Retreat Ministries Committee Council has had time to confer and come before the body to let you know that we support the principle and of repairing historical harm to indigenous people and of other communities of color. In the case of Camp Colby, this might mean donating some of the proceeds of the sale or participating in some of the land back effort.
As we take the next steps with Colby, we commit to making reparations to the Native American community a part of the plan for the sale of the camp. We will report back to the annual conference the details of this action. We also recognize that this work is not just the responsibility of Camping and Retreat Ministry. It is the responsibility of our entire annual conference. Therefore, we commit to initiating conversation with our conference Native American leaders, CORE, the Connectional Table, CFNA, and trustees about the possibility of creating a conference program or policy to guide us as we consider property sales in the future. Thank you.
Microphone two.
Thank you, Bishop. My name is Don Carlisle. I'm laity from Redondo Beach First, and I am rising to tell you that members of this conference, along with 1,500 of our other closest friends, completed the AIDS life cycle 1 week ago today. Happy to say I was one of them. And I would encourage anybody, and I mean anybody, to take part in this. I was inspired by Larry High last year, and I wanted to do the challenge to see if I could actually ride a bicycle from San Francisco to Los Angeles. I know I can now, because I did it. And it's a fine thing to want to challenge yourself in that way. But as I was training with the people of various backgrounds and learning their stories and learning the stories of the age life cycle and what it was about, it became more to me about supporting those people who live with HIV/AIDS. And I encourage you to consider it. You can sign up. It doesn't take much to sign up. You can sign up as a writer or as a roadie. That is a person who goes along and helps by providing meals, by setting up the campground, by setting up rest stops. Or you can sign up just as to raise money from home. And I encourage you to do that. Go to AIDSLifeCycle.org for all the information you need. Thank you very much, Bishop.
Thank you for your work. We're going to have a retirement video, then I'm going to go to three, or back to some of you that are requesting mics, but we're trying to get us out of here on time. Lots of good things being said, though. Thank you for that. Let's go to retirement video, but hold on. We'll be back to you.
For 43 years, it has been my honor and my privilege to serve God and the people of the United Methodist Church in the capacity of ordained ministry. It began in 1981 when I was among the 29 deacons who were the first ordination class in the Pacific Southwest Annual Conference to be ordained by Bishop Toole. And then 3 years later, in 1984, I was one of the 28 elders ordinands who were the last to be ordained in the Pacific and Southwest Conference before we became the California Pacific Annual Conference. In that time, I've served 11 churches in 10 appointments from Southeast Arizona to Hawaii, spanning the original span of the conference. Four times as an associate, I've served in a rural two-point charge. I've served suburban churches and urban churches. I've had Samoan and Japanese associate pastors, Tagalog assistant pastor, and been associated with ministries in Spanish, Gujarati, and of course Korean in the shared facility arrangement in Woodland Hills. My appointments have, many of them, been very multicultural, and among other things, this means that I have probably experienced the best potlucks of any pastor sitting here today. My churches have been involved in flood relief, in preschools, in after-school programs, and community outreach programs, community service programs, and of course, feeding the community in various different ways. I was a chaplain for 10 years in the Long Beach Police Department and the Los Angeles Police Department, and throughout my time have forged close ties between the first responders, the EMTs and firefighters, police and sheriffs in the places where I have served have known my churches. I want to share something that happened years ago at one of these retirement things. It was at the retirement of Dick Kane, and he lifted up the name of Moyer Pilsen. Moyer was a member of the Silverado United Methodist Church and a tireless worker within the Long Beach District. He did everything that anyone needed in any church. He was an amazing and fantastic layperson. And I honor his memory today by lifting his name, but also letting him stand for all of the hundreds of wonderful lay people I have come to know, and in many cases become very good friends with over these last 43 years. Because that's what it is all about. It is about people experiencing the love of God and being led to deepen their experience of the love of God and learning how best to share the love of God wherever it is that they find themselves. That is the essence of the people called Methodist. And those are the people it has been my privilege to serve with for 43 years. Thank you.
Microphone three.
Sharon Rhodes Wickett, clergy, retired relationship. A brief observation. yesterday, after Sister Sue Ann made her request about the Camp Colby property, I felt bereft. My spirit was troubled for the rest of the day and all night, and I wrestled with what that was about and what it felt like to me as something got shuffled off and sent away. And I thought we were going to do things in a new way. I thought that we would bring a different kind of spirit to how we address these issues. And the spirit moved, and things are happening. So I want to lift that up and give thanks and praise. I feel a sense of hope, and my spirit is feeling buoyed. What I want to affirm is that this is something for all of us to be about. And that was my biggest fear. It's going to be relegated to some committee someplace. Repentance being enfleshed in acts of renewal and revival and repair. And that's for all of us to do. Thank you.
Microphone three again is the next. Microphone three, you're next, and then we'll be microphone four.
Thank you. Reverend Sandy Richards, Los Altos clergy. I want to just acknowledge that notwithstanding Bishop Hoshibata's excellent sermon, today in the reading, the words were said, and take possession of the land. And I just wanted to, as a white person, stand up and say, white people, that was for Joshua, not for us. And we have a lot of work to do. And I my spirit was equally troubled as Sharon's about this. And I need to say that if Reverend Cynthia Abrams were still here today, she would be at the microphone instead of me. So I stand in her memory, a member of the Seneca Nation. Thank you.
Thank you. Microphone four.
Hi, Denise Barnes, clergy, appointed to the conference. I just wanted to let people know who weren't at the social justice dinner last evening that we gave an award of excellence in ministry to Jean Rose Smith for all the incredible work she's done at the 580 Cafe and the situations of love and companionship that she gives to students, particularly international students, who are food insecure, who have no money and often unhoused too. So I just wanted you all to know that without much help from anyone else, Jean has created this incredible ministry, and we awarded her for that last evening.
We are going to go to one more retirement video. It's our last one, then we'll come to these two microphones. I hope that then we can move on, because we need to get out of here. For my sake, not for yours. So, retirement video.
Ting Jie, 我爱你. Ting Jie, I love you. This was a call I heard in 1972 at a retreat in Malaysia. That call to share the love of Jesus led me to Rose, places, people, and challenges that I never imagined. Indeed, glory to God. I give thanks to many people and churches that have blessed me along the way. Without all of you, I won't be here today. I give thanks to my mother church, Kampong Methodist Church, Malaysia, which inspired me to explore all means of evangelism as our way to love Jesus. I have studied in 4 seminaries. I give thanks for Trinity Theological College in Singapore, my first seminary, which inspired me to love to study the Bible, to live a holy life, and the importance of theological education for the future of the church. The faculty demonstrated how to teach by our lives and to give faith to those who have no faith. Their example inspired me to follow God's still small voice. My first appointment consisted of 2 points in rural Sitiawan, Malaysia, in 1981 to 1984, Grace Methodist Church and Simban Lima, that showed me how ill-equipped I was, as well as the challenges and limitations for woman-ordained ministry. My connection with CalPAC Conference began with my journey of pursuing PhD at Claremont School of Theology when I began serving at Chinese UMC of Los Angeles. I never thought of becoming an ordained clergywoman, But I was ordained as deacon in 1990 and elder in 1994, serving then at Alhambra First UMC. My time at Chinese UMC of Los Angeles and Alhambra First UMC was very good in preparing me to be a pastor for pastors as missionary faculty in TTC, my alma mater, in Singapore after my PhD graduation in 2001. It was at TTC that my clergy woman role expanded as lecturer, dean of students, chaplain, counselor, and of course as a mother and wife to Reverend George Markson. I was very honored to be part of the Methodist mission in Singapore, as our founding father said, the world is my parish. God has blessed me the past 7 years at St. Gabriel First UMC after coming back from Singapore, spreading the good gospel and building up Chinese churches has offered many opportunities, but also challenges. I pray that Chinese churches can shine for Christ despite all the darkness in our society. Last but not least, I give thanks that God's seed in me has grown as a strong tree to provide shade for people thirsting for God's love. The future is unknown, but that tree will continue to grow. I look forward for the next journey of God's continuing good work in me and in the family. Amen.
Microphone 2.
Bishop, members of the annual conference, Frank Wolf, Echo Park United Methodist Church, also co-chair of the Equitable Compensation Commission. I'm going to phrase this as a question. Unless I've missed it, we have not approved the minimum salary schedule for pastors, and I'm wondering, is there a plan to do that either at this conference or at the conference in November?
Yes, there's a plan. The plan is the special session in November. That's part of the budget process that we are working on.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Number one.
Bishop and members of the annual conference, Mona Lisa Tuitahi, Laity Pomona Tongan. I stand to remind this annual conference that we have the rare gift of having a judicial council member in our midst and as one of our members, and particularly in this tumultuous time in the life of the church. He is a gift. And though often he has to recuse himself from our conversation, but having him here and having relationship with him is certainly a gift that I want to recognize, and also for the annual conference's prayer. So if Reverend Louis Tron is here, there he is. Your prayer.
Thank you so much. Did you want me to say a prayer for him?
Would you?
Okay, let's do that. Judicial counsel is a tough job. God, I pray that you be with Louis Tron. Thank you for the ways he leads us in the local church, in the conference, and in the global church of around our world. Thank you, God, for the United Methodists who stand with him to help us as we go forward in this time. Give him grace, give him extension of time in his life, and give him wisdom. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you, Louis. Okay, I'm going to call up Aaron to work us through some thank yous. And then after this session's, this piece of it, we're going to have a short liturgy and worship, and then we're going to be sending each other away.
All right. Good afternoon. Our murmuration has taken quite a journey over the last couple of days, but we've had a good conference this year, have we not? We have. And there, I've heard from so many of you about the good spirit that you've experienced, and many of us who work behind the scenes have already started talking about how we'll make things even better for our conference next year. So you know that there is a lot that goes into planning annual conference, and we certainly couldn't end this time without thanking all of the people who work so hard to make this happen. It starts with our sessions team that is chaired by our bishop, Bishop Dottie Escobedo Frank. It includes Jennifer Gaylord, John Demery, who is the leader of our media team. Let's give it up for the media team. who make everything happen, and who get so many last-minute additions to things, and they go with the flow. They're wonderful. Our lay leader, Melimaka, Jan Hansen, Archana Carey, Lydia Sohn, who oversaw our child care center. So for those who utilize that, we thank her for that. Wan Suk Ye, our secretary, Bob Rhodes, and our agenda chair, Kathy Kapp. Thank you so much for all that you do. Our worship team, that was Julie Elkins and Victor Cyrus Franklin, were the chairs of our worship team, along with Molly Lorden, Joy Yoon, and Carmen Ortiales. So give it up for the worship team. We also have, as a part of the sessions team, Sandy Ferruda, Tom Choi, Denise Barnes, and Kathy Wilson. So there are a lot of names here, and I'm just not going to read all these names, but I will highlight for you the main organizers of our conference. So we give it up for our cabinet, who's here holding things down, our house band. Haven't they been wonderful? So we really have to speak your names, because you have just brought such a wonderful spirit. I can introduce you, Stephen Folds, who is the leader of our house band, Kobe Esfle, Salvador Villanueva, Jorge Villanueva, and Reverend Mandy McDowell. We had a wonderful ordination service this morning and are so grateful for everyone on our Board of Ordained Ministry and our orders who make the ordination service possible. The Sheraton Gateway LAX and Sonesta hotel staff, the catering staff, front desk and hotel staff, our housekeeping staff, the special events staff, valet and parking staff, all of the people who make our living here together for a few days possible. Let's give it up for them. And the bishop gave some awards earlier today, and so we thank all of the people who work behind the scenes, particularly Margaret Irwin. Margaret, are you here? Who also does so much to support us behind the scenes and her team for the bishop's award. And for the conference staff and event volunteers, if you're a conference staff person or have volunteered to be a part of the team for annual conference, just stand for a moment so we can recognize all of our conference staff who work for months to make this happen. And our volunteers. And I think that is my media team. Oh, yes, our translation. We have had translation going on during the conference, organized by Reverend Moon Young Lee, and we've had a number of translators who've been working throughout the conference, so thank you so much for allowing your services to make this a multicultural event. Oh, the backdrop. This I think we announced that it was Faith Church in Torrance, that the wonderful volunteers that made the backdrop. And with that, Bishop, thank you so much for your leadership, and thank all of you for being here with us this year, and we'll see you next year.
Bob.
Aaron, you did forget to point out how much work you have done to frame this annual conference. Well, maybe you didn't forget, but I did. What? Okay. Friends, it has been a privilege to journey with you at this annual conference. You may recall that our Book of Discipline, paragraph 603.3, says the annual conference or a committee thereof shall select the place for holding the conference. It is a lot of work to find a place that will house us accommodate us in all the things that we want to do. We know that there are things that we would still love to be doing, and an effective team has to navigate all the contracting and complexity, things like, is it a union hotel? What is the proximity to airports as we consider our folks who will be flying in from islands and elsewhere? Is it a place that has enough infrastructure to accommodate the technology? There are so many difficult decisions, and I want to simply highlight how hard it is and how complex it is, and how grateful your sessions team is that we are entrusted with this good work. The intent of the sessions team is to recognize the incredible hospitality among our various districts. And while there's been no specific location selected for next year yet, we are looking in the North District so that we might experience the hospitality of the North District. Thank you, friends.
All right. Speaking of next year, it is my job to choose the date. And this may be difficult because it requires change. Are we okay with that? This is a little change in the whole scheme of life, but I'm going to change the date from not the weekend around Father's Day, but the week before. So it will be June 5th through 9th, 2024. Some like it, some don't. That's the way we. That's okay. We're gonna make this work, and then we'll reevaluate and see how it works for us as a conference after next year. So I also want to say, as we move into our closing worship moment, I want to say thank you to Margaret and to Roxana, who have taken care of me and Chica along this journey. And I'm just grateful for all that you've done. And I want to say thank you to my husband, Jim, who runs back to the hotel room to get me this or that or bring me coffee in the morning or... You know, he's just put up with me during this time. And just want to tell you, hon, we're going to go walk on the beach today. So we'll make it all work out. and I want you all to know that I am taking a period of time off here for this parts of the summer. So you may see that when you email me, you get one of those responses that are automatic. But you'll be with me in my heart, and I pray that you will find the ways to rest for yourself as well. Let's move towards worship.
Sabes, Señor, que hoy está peor es mucho el dolor. Hay mucho egoísmo y mucha maldad. Señor, por mi bien, yo quiero vivir un día a la vez.
Sing the chords again.
Un día a la vez, mi Cristo. Es lo que pido de ti. Dame la fuerza para vivir un día a la vez. Ayer ya pasó, mi Cristo, y mañana quizás no vendrá. Ayúdame hoy, yo quiero vivir un día a la vez.
Thank you.
doctors and their healing work. Here's to the loved ones and their care. Here's to the strangers on the streets tonight. Here's to the lonely everywhere. Here's to the wisdom from the mouths of babes. Here's to the lions in the cage. Here's to the struggles of the silent war. Here's to the closing of the gate.
Please join me in the call to worship. Creator God, we gather together from many places, past, and communicate to celebrate and worship together as your people. Jesus, life giver, we celebrate all that brings us together. We are on a journey, learning and celebrating. Spirit of love, we are a living community and we give thanks for the moment, for the movement of the Spirit, ever inspiring, strengthening, moving, and challenging us. Amen. Please rise for the opening hymn. They'll know we are Christians by our love.
Actually, we're going to do a song before that called Kyrie.
Kyrie, sorry.
But I think you'll recognize it, okay? So just hang in there for a second.
Kyrie eleison. Against this mountainside, across the sea into my soul, it reaches into where I cannot hide, setting my feet upon the road. My heart is old, it holds my memory. It burns a gem like clay. Somewhere between the soul and soft machine is where I find myself again. Here we go. Kyrie eleison, down the road that I must travel. Kyrie eleison, through the darkness of the night. Hey, Kyrie eleison, where I'm going, will you follow? And on the highway and the line. When I was young, the thought of growing old, oh, what my life would mean to me. Would I have followed down my chosen road, or only wish that I could be? Let's sing that chorus again. Kyrie eleison, down the road that I must travel. Kyrie eleison, through the darkness of the night. Hey, Kyrie eleison, where I'm going, will you follow? Will you? Kyrie eleison, on the highway in the night. Oh.
sing, oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh.
Let's modulate, here we go. Kyrie eleison, down the road that I must travel. Kyrie eleison, into the darkness of the night. Hey.
Beautiful.
Give me a lesson on the highway in the light.
Amen.
Y'all some good singers.
They'll know we are Christian.
The scripture is in Luke 24, 13 through 35. The walk to Emmaus. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad.
Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted them to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near to the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread." Amen.
It's the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. My name is Joy Yoon. I'm pastor of Keolumana United Methodist Church in Kailua, Hawaii. And it's my honor and privilege to introduce our speaker today, the Reverend Saul Montiel, my friend and colleague. He is an elder in full connection in our conference and came to us from the Desert Southwest Conference. He is a graduate from the Claremont School of Theology and has served churches in Arizona and California. In addition, Pastor Montiel has served as a U.S.'s and Mexico's border missionary for the General Board of Global Ministry, as well as being an adjunct professor for CST and Course of Studies. Reverend Montiel has chaired the Inter-Ethnic Coordinating Committee of the Western Jurisdiction, as well as Marcha, the Hispanic Jurisdictional Caucus. He is currently the pastor of Downey United Methodist Church. Please give him a warm welcome.
This is our last meal of the conference. We'll be fed again, and we've been feeding a lot lately. I came to the CALPA conference in 2011 as a U.S. and Mexico's border missionary, and since then, the border has been in my heart, and I go very often to do ministry and also with visit my family and issues of the family. In the month of May, I went back to the border again with an interfaith group of people from Los Angeles, clergy and lay. We went because all we want to do was learn about the work of El Comedor Juan 635, or the John 635 dining room. I don't see the picture, so I provide the picture, but you can see them. I hope technology can provide the picture. Thank you. This is a feeding program of the Methodist Church of Mexico and AMCOR in Tijuana. And this ministry is a huge open dining room that serves freshly cooked meal to anyone who comes. The ministry literally incarnates the work of Jesus of feeding the hungry, both physically and spiritually. Bishop Felipe Ruiz is appointed to this extension ministry, and he chairs the table with immigrants, or as they call it in Tijuana, migrants, migrantes, who are being deported, obviously from the U.S., or are waiting to cross into the U.S. to possibly apply for asylum. And after having a teaching moment of the Word of God, Bishop Ruiz takes the meal for the day, bless it, breaks it into hundreds of portions, and gives it to all who come to the table to be fed. I've seen that. During this visit, however, my heart was touched immensely. I learned that feeding people is so novel. It's so novel. It's so powerful. It is truly sacramental. It's so holy that the institution of Holy Communion is based on this notion. There, the presence of Christ becomes real and inviting through the sharing of the love of God through the meal. The Gospels also include similar stories, many of them. We find Christ as the bread of life, championing table sharing and feeding the hungry. He loved feeding people so much that he made the act a moment of fellowship and acceptance, so much that he practiced it often. As God's son and the leaders of all the disciples, he had no problem whatsoever with waiting at tables. So he instituted unique, you know, gestures and language when he loved to do that, when sharing the table with others, that we also use the same gestures and languages when we do communion in our churches. As he fed the hungry, he distinctively took bread, blessed it, broke the bread, and gave it to people. He remarkably transformed giving food into a profound act of love, fellowship, and acceptance to the table. So table sharing is precisely at the heart of the account of Emmaus. It's late, and Cleopas and another disciple, who probably is his wife, are arriving at the village of Emmaus. It's been a 7-mile journey from Jerusalem, and they are tired and hungry. They need to eat. They left the group of disciples in Jerusalem dismayed, heartbroken, and hopeless. Why? Just figure it out. It's the third day of Jesus' death. And in these two disciples' minds, there is no clear evidence that he is alive. So they are devastated. They had great hope he would restore and redeem Israel. But unfortunately, their hope has been vanished, for now he is dead. On their way to Emmaus, however, as they discuss how their teacher and leader has been killed before their very own eyes, Jesus, the fellow traveler, joins them on the road and becomes alongside them, but they don't recognize him. They think he is a stranger, someone who does not look like them. But they welcome him anyway. It's okay, you can join our walk. So what is this you are talking about? Jesus asked them, and looking quite surprised that he did not know about the events of the weekend, Cleopas, one of the disciples, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know what happened there?" how strange. Then they both, the wife and the husband, obviously, told him about the whole passion and death story of Jesus of Nazareth. Highlighting, however, the women's mourning visit to the tomb. According to the women, Jesus' body wasn't in the tomb when they went early on that day. Instead, they claim having had a vision of angels who told them he was alive. When they finish, Jesus takes the authority of teacher and exhorts their unbelief on what the prophet had declared about the Messiah and how he should suffer before entering his glory. Beginning with Moses, the Pentateuch, and all the prophets, he interpreted for them the things about Jesus himself. It is precisely then when the journey comes to an end. Jesus, however, keeps walking ahead as if he is going beyond the village. All he wanted was for them to invite him, and probably Jesus had a question in his mind, if they only invite me. All it takes is for them to invite me. And you'll see what's gonna happen. Jesus, who they thought was a stranger, had nourished their soul all the way along. He was the bread of life, obviously. He made them feel their hearts, as a Methodist, strangely warm on the road as he opened the scriptures and taught them. Then they say, don't go. Don't leave us alone. You just can go out. There's no possible way you're going to go. You're very welcome into our house. You have to stay. Upon Jesus' acceptance or their invitation, they proceed to prepare dinner. The table is set and all are gathered around the table. The two disciples know that Jesus, although, you know, he seems to be a teacher. He thinks he is a rabbi or some sort of teacher because the way he taught them with authority on the road. So he is welcome and has a very special place in their home. So Jesus feels like being home. I'm home. So he has nourished them spiritually with his teaching, you know that, and now he is about to feed them the physical bread as he had done for many people before. So Jesus takes the bread, blesses it, breaks the bread, and gives it to them, transforming the table sharing into a sacramental meal again. When they saw these gestures at the breaking of the meal, you know, the very gestures and languages that we do, and how he shared the bread, the meal, and how he blessed the meal, they immediately recognized him through the gestures and language Jesus used. They have seen the same gestures and heard the same words of blessing before when Jesus fed them. Jesus had done it at the Last Supper, and they know, they remember that. We saw the same gestures, and Jesus has done it also at the feeding of the 5,000, the same gesture. Suddenly, that table was transformed into a sacramental meal, a means of grace, a vehicle whereby the presence of Christ became real and inviting. At that moment, they realized they had walked and shared their table not with a stranger, but with the risen Christ. He had never left them alone. That's what they learned. And after having nourished them both physically and suddenly and revealing himself to them, he disappeared from their sight. His job is done. But they have been fed and strengthened by the bread of life. All hope is recovered. They are now nourished to resume their work. They must now go back to Jerusalem with the rest of the disciples they left to tell them that indeed the women were right. Well, they are always right, by the way. For indeed they have seen the risen Christ and shared table with him. They ran back to Jerusalem to share the good news. They shared the table with the risen Christ. I know we have also been fed in this gathering and shared the table with Christ for these days. During this, our holy conferencings of the United Methodist Church and the Kalpa Conference, and now we are ready to go. We've been strengthened, nourished. And in the next few days, we'll go back to our churches and also to our ministries. Know that Christ, our breath of life, and our faithful companion, goes along with us as we all journey together through our appointments, respected appointments. We can count on Christ's continuous spiritual and physical nourishment. We know journeying with Christ leads to the table. Okay. So we will sit and share table with others because this is what ministry is all about. I don't know if you have forgotten about this, but this is what ministry is all about. It's about sharing and bringing strangers, those who are not yet at the table, and share with us. We have so much space in our churches and rooms that are not being used. So let us share our church's table with all who live in our community, even though our communities and neighborhoods have changed, full of strangers. Remember that Christ's presence is in the strangers. When we invite to the table, we invite this presence. The two disciples of Emmaus invited Christ to the table thinking that he was a stranger. And we learn that as a means of grace, table sharing is sacramental in the right place for substantial change. You know the transubstantiation? This is where we are remembered. We are brought back into the body of Christ, to the family of God. Here is where the risen Christ is shown unexpectedly, bringing communion and fellowship to all. So let us go with Christ's authority and clean tables. I mean, I can stay there for some time, but I think you understand what I meant, right? I don't know if I need to mention all the particularities, you know, we have declared and pronounced ourselves against racist practice and sexist practices of our churches. I mean, we know that this is not something new. So we, through Christ's authority, can clean the tables from those racist and sexist practices of our churches and ministries, and also the issues that divide us. Make it a safe place for all, for the risen Christ is leading the way always. See who is not at the tables, at the church's tables in this case. Invite the stranger, those who does not look like you or who do not look like you, and gather everybody around. Let us turn our churches into places of fellowship and acceptance where all are welcome regardless of who they are. And like Christ, let us wait at the table, take bread, bless it, break the bread, and give it to all who come to be fed. For it is Christ's table, and he is inviting all. So let therefore, like the Great Commission, so let therefore the risen Christ be made known to all in the breaking of the bread, and make of table sharing a sacrament that ends spiritual and physical hunger in the world. Amen.
Life looms ahead of us, huge and uncertain. In the confusion, we must listen for the voice of God. Who can hear the voice of God calling?
The expectations of our friends feel so overwhelming, luring us to make choices for our own comfort. Who focus on the call to serve God?
Hunger, greed, hopelessness prevail in our world, making it difficult to believe that God still does. Who can speak good news in the face of evil?
Here I am,
our voice seems so small against the misery we hear. Wars and famines and abuse seem dominant. Who can be heard above the crying?
The world is waiting to hear the promise of God, a life of justice, peace, and love for all of God's children. Who will choose this life with God?
Send me.
Perfect submission,
This is my story. I'll testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Watch this.
Sing, this is my story. I'll testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Now I'm here. Sing, this is my story. I'll testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Now I am here. Sing. Is mine. This is my story. This is my soul. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my praising my Savior all the day long.
Here we go.
Sing, this is my story. I testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Now I am His. This is my story. Testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Now I am here. Sing, this is my story. I testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Now I am here. So one more time. This is my story. I testify that God is good all the time. He saw me and heard my cry. Now I am His.
Amen. God bless you all. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of this incredible event.
All right. We have conferenced. We have had holy conferencing. We have fellowshipped. We have legislated. We have worshiped. And so now I declare this the 39th annual conference of the California Pacific Conference to be over. Done. And now receive this blessing from God as you leave this space. Go from here, holy people, and take this sacred love that has been rained down on your soul and take it out to the world that doesn't always know that someone cares. And love them until there's no more spiritual hunger. And feed them until there's no more physical hunger. And be God's light and love and joy into our world so that we too can live heaven on earth. Do so in the name of the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer. Amen.
Amen.
Safe travels.
One last song, it's called Ring the Bells. It's an easy chorus, too.
Ring the bell, this time I mean it. Bid the hatred fairly well. Give back the pieces of my Jesus. Take your counterfeit to hell.
Bang the drums, this means war.
But not the kind you're waiting for. We say mercy won't be rationed here. That's what we're fighting for.
All is fair in love and war. And what the hell is a loving even for? We can't sing it loud enough. We'll keep on adding voices up.
Ring the bells. Ring the bells.
For so long behind your statues and your steeples, does that get too close to home?
Well, I got faith to move a mountain
and to watch that mountain move. It's time for words to fall like thunder, sound of justice breaking through.
Fall in spirit, love and more. And what the hell is a love and even for? The world laughs and the martyrs sing, the love breaks through the cavalry.
Ring the bells, ring the bells. It's dead of sun, but I ain't the only one. What's in the throne room of a kingdom where I found that I belong?
I ain't scared to face a fortress.
I have seen them fall before. With broken bones you built it, but it crumbled board by board.
All is fair in love and war. And what the hell is love and even
of my Jesus? Take your counterfeit to hell.